Hello, Crossing Church. How are you doing? You doing okay? It's good to see you. I want to welcome everyone that's joining with us, everyone from Macomb and Kirksville and 929, everyone that's joining from Pittsfield and Lima and Hannibal. We are so glad that you're joining us. We have an opportunity to be a family together, and God is doing some incredible, incredible stuff in our body. It's awesome. He's moving powerfully, and I can see it. And I hope you can see it as well. I've seen people get access to the Lordship of Christ like never before. I mean it. Especially in the area of the Word of God. You guys are really diving into the Word of God. You're using those reading plans. You're going through that reading plan. God's opening your heart up to all kinds of things. You know what's awesome? We printed 5,000 reading plans. They were all gone, so we had to print 5,000 more reading plans. That's pretty awesome. You know, I was teaching on my Wednesday night Bible study, and I asked some obscure question, like, did you understand what this meant? And about 80% just looked at me, and they shook their heads like they had read through that and had a question about it. 80%, I'm just going, this is great. People are in the Word, and I'll tell you what. When you're in the Word, God's going to get in you. And some amazing things are going to happen. Second thing I'm seeing is just the level of sustaining the giving that came through the ABC's series. It's awesome what God's doing and how you're turning that over to the Lordship of Christ. Our giving has literally doubled overnight, and we've sustained that for the last 7 weeks. And what this tells me is that so many of you are saying, I'm just giving this part of my life over to the Lordship of Christ. And I keep seeing it illustrated in stories. Listen, if you haven't joined the Crossing Financial Freedom page, there's about 315 families that have joined. Join it. And if you have something that you need to share, there's a great place to do it, to encourage other people. And if you need encouraged, if you need people to pray for you, that's a great place for that to happen as well. So join that page, and you know what? Keep Him Lord. Whether we're talking about being in the Word or whether we're talking about making sure that He stays in the Lordship of our financial lives, keep Him Lord, because that's the only place He deserves to be in your life, and that is in control of it, Lord of it. So let's recap where we've been with the story. We talked about the creation and how God started it all, what He did and how he did it on which days. We talked about the crown of His creation, mankind, because God was actually procreating in that. We talked about the fall, this horrible nature. We really sometimes really don't realize how far we actually fell. But even in the midst of that, we saw the hope that God provided in Genesis 3:15 and through the coats of skins that He provided as a covering for Adam and Eve. We saw those generations go down to Noah and how every imagination of a man's heart was only evil continually. And God was sorry that He made man. He grieved in His heart that He'd done that. And so He decides to destroy man. But He's going to stay true to His promise that He said in the garden on that day that we fell. And so Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And he and his family survived that great flood in an ark that God instructed him to build. And after that flood was over and the earth, everything on the earth had been destroyed, God repopulated the earth with Noah's family and with everything that was contained in that ark. And then we see this progression down to Abraham. And God picks a nation. He picks a people. And He says that Abraham's going to be the father of it. We heard that last week. And now we're seeing it move down through the patriarchs. Abraham has Isaac. Isaac has Jacob and Esau. But the promise and the covenant moves through Jacob. And then Jacob has 12 sons. Now over half of the book of Genesis is about Jacob and his family. See, Jacob is later renamed. And his new name that God gives him is Israel. And so we see that Israel and his 12 sons that become the 12 tribes of Israel is where God's covenant blessing is all going to move through. And that's where we're going to pick it up. And we're going to concentrate on one son. I know there's a lot of great stories about all of them, But we're going to concentrate on one son, and that's a pretty familiar one to a lot of us. It's the story of Joseph, the 11th of 12 sons. Now, when we look at the story of Joseph, you're going to experience something incredible. It's an incredible story where God teaches us great lessons. And in order to understand this story, we need to divide it up into five sections. And if you look at Joseph's life, it really is a story with five sections to it, like five chapters, a little mini story in a larger story. Chapter one, from birth to 7 years old, the golden child becomes a stepchild. Let's read together. Genesis chapter 30, verses 22 to 24. It says, "Then God remembered Rachel. He listened to her and opened her womb. She became pregnant and gave birth to a son and said, 'God has taken away my disgrace.' And she named him Joseph. And she said, 'May the Lord add to me another son.'" To understand this properly, let's get a little bit of background. This would have been an incredible reality show. I think it would have been started out called Pregnancy Wars. See, and there was a lot of drama even before that with what happened with Jacob and falling in love with Rachel and finding out on the wedding night that he'd married the wrong one and the father-in-law had slipped him a fast one, you know, and all of a sudden it's Leah the next morning, Rachel's sister, and he has to work 14 years instead of 7. You need to read that if you haven't already read it in your reading plan. But after they were both married, Pregnancy Wars started Monday night, 7 o'clock on A&E. Anyway, and Rachel was barren. She couldn't have children. But Leah, she was a baby factory, okay? So she starts having kids. And that causes all kinds of division, which started the sequel to Pregnancy Wars. And that was Concubine Wars. And so both Leah and Rachel gave concubines to Jacob in order to proliferate, in order to have children. And so they start having children. What a mess! But that's what happens. And the sum total of that was 10 sons and a daughter. 10 sons and a daughter. And then later in life, Rachel, the love of his life, gets pregnant. And this is the culmination of that. She has a son and names him Joseph. You know, he was a golden child. He had 10 older brothers, but he was the one. I mean, Joseph and Rachel looked at that, and Rachel saw Joseph as her vindication, and Joseph saw the product of his great love to Rachel, and that created instant favoritism. And instant favoritism created instant jealousy. Jealousy from the other wives and concubines. Jealousy from the 10 older boys. But from Joseph's perspective, this is awesome. I mean, I'm getting everything. So from the time he was born until he was 7 years old, it was great. And then something happened. Something that was supposed to be a time of great joy, but it immediately twisted and became a time of great sorrow. Rachel was pregnant again. She was going to have another son. And I would imagine that Joseph and that Jacob were just so excited about that. And they were on the road. They're actually near Bethlehem. And they were traveling when it came time for her to deliver. And she had difficulties in delivery and died in the process of delivering her second son, Benjamin. And what was beautiful became tragic. And when you look at Joseph's life, instantly, he went from the golden child to the stepchild. And he had 3 stepmothers that didn't like him. And 10 older brothers. Now, and 1 younger brother, but 10 older brothers that didn't like him either. Wow. So this took him from chapter 1 to chapter 2. Because Joseph's great world is about to turn upside down. What would it have been like for Joseph suddenly to lose his mother and then to have these three stepmothers that want to favor their children, and they see that Jacob prefers Joseph over those other 10 boys. What would it be like to grow up in that home? What kind of social politics, domestic politics would be in there? What would he be dealing with? How would his 10 older brothers deal with him when Jacob wasn't around? What would that have been like? You know, that would have been hard. But you know, there's something about this kid, Joseph. No matter what the circumstances is in his life, he finds a way to glorify God, and God does amazing things through him. And that's what I see in this story that's just so awesome. Because in chapter 2, Joseph goes from a stepchild to a slave. It's from the ages of 7 to 17. But those 10 years in between, Joseph didn't allow the circumstance of losing his mother to stop him from honoring and glorifying God. But it didn't stop his brothers and his stepmothers from despising him. Let's look at the three strikes that happened to him, okay? You find it in Genesis chapter 37. In verse 2, it says this. This is the account of Jacob. Joseph, a young man of 17, was tending the flocks with his brothers, the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah. Those are the concubines, by the way, from Concubine Wars. And his father's wives, and he brought their father a bad report about them. Strike one. What'd he do? He ratted on his older brothers. What do you suppose that made, how did that make them feel? Well, they already didn't like him because of the favoritism, and now he's ratted them out. Strike one. Strike two. Look at verses 3 and 4. Now Israel, that's Jacob, loved Joseph more than any of his other sons, because he had been born to him in his old age, and he made a richly ornamented robe for him. When his brothers saw their father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him. Strike two. The favoritism of his father goes to this extreme, that with his own hands he makes a coat for his son, and then his son wears it in front of his brothers. And that has just got to grate on them. And now this dislike is kind of moving to hatred, and they really can't stand him. Then strike three happens, and that's in verses 5 to 10. It says, Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him all the more. He said to them, listen to this dream I had. We were binding sheaves of grain out in the field when suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright, while your sheaves gathered around mine and bowed down to it. His brothers said to him, do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule us? And they hated him all the more because of the dream and what he had said. Then he had another dream. And he told it to his brothers. Listen, he said, I had another dream. This time, the sun and the moon and 11 stars were bowing down to me. And when he told his father as well as his brothers, his father rebuked him and said, what is this dream you had? Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow down to the ground before you? His brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the matter in mind. Interesting. See, Joseph's experiencing the favor of God. He's got a gift. God gives him the ability to have dreams and then interpret those dreams. And he's just naive enough or prideful enough to share them with his brothers and with his father. I don't think he's ashamed of what God is saying. And you can draw all sorts of implications from that. But the actual issue that comes from that is the next stage of his life, chapter 3. You see, what happens is Joseph gets sent out while he's wearing his great, cool coat to his brothers with supplies from his father. And that hatred has fomented up so much in those brothers that they decide they're going to kill him. So they throw him into a pit to try to figure out how they're going to do it. And there so happens to be an Ishmaelite or Midianite caravan that comes by. And instead of killing their brother, they decide to sell him into slavery for 20 pieces of silver. Then they take his coat and rip it up and pour lamb's blood on it take it back to their father and said, a wild animal's killed Joseph, your favorite son. So now we enter into chapter 3 or stage 3 of Joseph's life, a slave. And from 17 to 27, that's what he is. But he's still not done going down, because he's going to go from a slave to a prisoner. A slave to a prisoner. You know, it's interesting that even though he became a slave and these Ishmaelites took him to Egypt and sold him to a man named Potiphar, that Potiphar was the captain of the guard. He was connected to the royalty, Pharaoh's house in Egypt. And that's who decided to buy Joseph. Joseph, even in that situation as a slave, found favor. God was with him. And it didn't take long before he started rising through the slave ranks. And before long, he was in charge of a few, and then a few more, and then a lot more. And then he was in charge of everything in the field, and then he was in charge of everything in the house, to the point that Potiphar, his owner, said, I'm going to put you in charge of everything. I can see that God's with you, and as long as you're in charge, great things are going to happen, and besides, all I really care about is eating. Yeah, it's in there. Verse 6 of chapter 39. Look at verse 6 of chapter 39. It's actually a very important verse. It says this, so he left in Joseph's care everything he had with Joseph in charge. He did not concern himself with anything except the food he ate. Wow. Why is that so important? I'll tell you why. Because if you're fat and all you care about is food, you're going to end up with a desperate housewife. Now, she may have married the right guy economically, but she sure didn't marry the right guy romantically, did she? And Potiphar really didn't care what was going on. And that takes Joseph to chapter 4. That's what gets him in the trouble that he's in. Because you see, as Joseph is rising up through the ranks of the slavery or the house of Potiphar, and finally gets in the house, and now what is he? Now he's a guy and he's wearing Egyptian clothes, and he's sitting at the desk and he's doing all the bills and got the checkbook out, and he's figuring out how to make more money and increase all of Potiphar's holdings. He is in eyesight of Potiphar's wife. Now, if you look at the fashion of the time, do you know what guys who dressed Egyptian wore? Do you know what they wore? They wore a linen skirt, a pleated linen skirt, bare-chested, and then they wore shoulder pads, and then they would cover their heads. So he is sporting the eight-pack, man. He has got it out. He's got it going on. The Bible says that this guy was well built and handsome. That means he was good looking all the way up and all the way down. He got a face to match the body. Boom, and he's in Egypt. I know, I didn't do anything when I did, I know. It all just stays there, doesn't it? I know, it's pathetic. Pray for my wife. Anyway, that's going to be important to know, even though you think I'm just being funny. That's actually important to know. Because what happens? Well, when he's in the eyesight of Potiphar's wife, and Potiphar's wife's the desperate housewife, she's finding him really attractive. Now remember, even though Joseph is in charge of everything in the house, he's still a what? He's still a slave. And if you're a slave, that means you're somebody's what? Property. That means they can do with you whatever they want. Right? And in Jewish culture, in Jewish culture to some extent, men to women, but in Egyptian culture, it was perfectly fine for her to command him to have a sexual relationship with her. I don't know if you think about, we always think about Potiphar's wife as some floozy, right? But she was just exercising her right of ownership. I'm a desperate housewife, come and lie with me. That's what the Bible says, right? And he's like, hey, no way. Can't do that. Do you know what that is? That's a slave defying his owner. Right? We want to think of fair, but it's not quite that. Remember, he's a slave. That's a slave defying his owner. And so he tried to avoid her, tried to stay away from her, but she found him. And there came this one time when she's extremely desperate, and she's like grabbing at him, and she gets a hold of that skirt. And by the way, that was it. And he took off running, and she kept the skirt. So he's streaking. And she is so angry because she's been put off, because she's been resisted, that she comes up with a story that he was trying to make sport of her. The scripture says that he was trying to make advances to her, and she had the proof of it. And she brought in all the household slaves and said, look what he did. And then she brings in Potiphar and said, look what he did. And that takes him to stage four of his life, chapter four. Because he goes from a slave to a prisoner. And being a prisoner, he wasn't just a prisoner anywhere. He was a prisoner in Pharaoh's prison. Remember, Potiphar is a very powerful man. He's the captain of the guard that protects Pharaoh. He's a very, very important, very powerful, well-connected man. And so his prisoners go in the same prison that Pharaoh's does. So it's kind of like the Tower of London. You know, it's not like a hole in the ground like you might think. It's actually a place for very important people. And when Joseph is in there, remember, it just keeps getting worse, right? He goes from golden child to stepchild. He goes from stepchild to slave. He goes from slave to prisoner. So now he's a prisoner. But even there, God blesses him. And it isn't long before the warden sees just how great a guy Joseph is. And he starts giving Joseph more and more responsibility until Joseph's in charge of the whole prison. It doesn't seem like there's any place you can put Joseph where he can't rise to the top. Guy's pretty awesome. And you think about it. At any one of these moments, could Joseph gone, you know what, I give up. This is crazy. But he doesn't. Seems like no matter where he is, he's given God glory. And God is just lifting him up. God's just helping him out. And so now he's in charge of the whole prison. And there's these two guys that are also prisoners. The cupbearer and the baker. Both of them responsible for the food that Pharaoh eats. I wonder what happened. I wonder if someone tried to poison Pharaoh. He didn't know which one it was. And so he put them both in prison. And lo and behold, what happens? These two guys have dreams. And Joseph tells them that he has this ability from God to interpret dreams. And so they tell him his dreams. And the cupbearer goes first, tells him his dream. And Joseph says, you know what that means? You got good news, man. God's given you some good news. In 3 days, and it's the Pharaoh's birthday, he's going to set you free. And he's going to restore you to the position you had before. The baker tells him his story. And he goes, not such good news. What God's going to do is kill you in 3 days. As a matter of fact, he says to the cupbearer that Pharaoh's going to lift up his head. And then he says to the baker, Pharaoh's going to lift off your head. And exactly what he says comes true 3 days later. Well, he asked the cupbearer to tell Pharaoh that he's down there and he's an innocent guy. But of course, the cupbearer forgets. So the next 3 years of his life is spent as a prisoner in this jail of Pharaoh. Probably wondering if he's been forgotten by God, but still doing what he's doing. And that takes him to the next stage of his life because he goes from prisoner to governor in 3 years. You see, it happens in Genesis 39, 20, the second part of 20 to 23. Let's read that. It says, but while Joseph was there in prison, the Lord was with him and showed him kindness and granted him favor in the eyes of the prison warden. And the warden put Joseph in charge of all that he had in the prison, and he was made responsible for all that was done there. The warden paid no attention to anything under Joseph's care because the Lord was with Joseph and gave him success in whatever he did. Now, I want you to see what happens next. Joseph is in the prison, and Pharaoh has a dream. He has a dream about cows, and he has dreams about kernels of wheat, and nobody can interpret it, and he's going all bonkers inside, and the cupbearer remembers that guy that's down in the prison that interpreted that dream for him, and he says, I know a guy that can do that for you, and they bring Joseph out of the prison, and they wash him up, and they make him shave, and kind of get him presentable for Pharaoh, and he goes in front of Pharaoh, and Pharaoh tells him his dream, and then Joseph says, you know what, I have no ability at all. But my God has all the ability. That tells you something about Joseph right there. And he says, what this means is that there's going to be 7 years of incredible plenty in the land of Egypt. It's going to be followed by 7 years of famine. And you need to prepare for it. So Pharaoh looks around. The only guy that could interpret the dream was Joseph. And he goes, hey, I'm putting you in charge. So you're in charge of this whole process. As a matter of fact, I'm going to put you in charge of everything in all of Egypt except me. Everything else. I'm going to even give you a woman as your wife, the priest of On's daughter. And all of a sudden, Joseph is in this incredibly high position. And he takes over during the 7 years of plenty. And all of this, he taxes all of Egypt 20%. And it all comes in. He builds storehouses for all of it. And sure enough, just like he said, after that 7 years of plenty comes the famine. And the people of Egypt are starving to death. And Joseph opens up all of these storehouse cities. And everyone in Egypt has enough. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that there was so much grain that Joseph stored up during this time that they stopped keeping records of it. It was so much. And then that famine extended out, and it even went to Canaan. Even went to Canaan, where Joseph's brothers were and where his father was. And of course, they heard. It was 9 years. Afterwards, 2 years into the famine, after the 7 years of plenty, Joseph's 39 years old, and Jacob decides to send his sons to Egypt in order to get food because they're all starving to death. So they go and get food, and when they get there, Joseph immediately recognizes his brothers, but his brothers don't recognize him. He was 17 when they left. He's 39 now. He's dressed up like an Egyptian. You know, he walks like an Egyptian, and he's got the hair, and he's got the eyes, and he's got all that stuff. And I mean, they couldn't recognize him, but he recognized them. And so he starts a process. He wants to check out their hearts. Have they changed? See, Joseph's changed. He doesn't hold that animosity in his heart because he could see God in all of it. But he wanted to know if they changed. So he went through this process with them. How many brothers are there? How big's your house? And he finds out that there's one at home named Benjamin. Of course, he knew who that was and wondered why Benjamin wasn't there. And then he says, you're all spies. And he locks up one of the brothers, Simeon. And he says, you aren't going to get any more food until you bring Benjamin so I can see him because I think you're spies. They had to take that message back to their father. And father goes, well, I guess that's the end of Simeon. Because he loved Benjamin. It's all he had left from Rachel. Until they started to starve again. And then he said, well, we're starving. I can watch Benjamin starve or I can risk his life by sending him with you to get more grain. So they decided to risk Benjamin's life. And you know what Judah said, the oldest boy? He said, you can kill me if I don't bring Benjamin back. And this whole process happens again, and you can read the story, and it's pretty amazing. But the end of that process is an incredible scripture that I want to read to you from the 44th chapter. And it's what Judah says in verses 33 and 34, the oldest boy, the one responsible for selling Joseph into slavery, said, now then, please let your servant remain here as my Lord's slave in place of the boy. And let the boy return with his brothers. How can I go back to my father if the boy is not with me? No, do not let me see the misery that would come upon my father. Do you know what that's called? It's called repentance. He can't take back what he did to Joseph. That secret that's buried in his heart, he can't take that back, but he doesn't have to repeat it. Not this time. No, this time, take me instead of Benjamin. And that was it for Joseph. He couldn't hold it in anymore. And that next chapter is all about Joseph saying, I'm your brother Joseph. And he reveals himself. They're scared to death. He's going to kill us. But he doesn't have any of that in his heart. And he shows them how much he loves them. And he sends them back with all the food in the world. And they have this news to tell their father. Joseph's alive. And Israel comes to Egypt with his whole family to be sustained because of Joseph. Now, that's a lot of chapters of the Bible. And I thank you for sticking with me. But I said all that so I could say this. There's an upper story and there's a lower story. You know what God's upper story is? He's going to build a nation for himself. He's going to make good on that promise that happened in the Garden of Eden. Those coats of skins that were provided by the shedding of blood. He's going to make good on that promise in Genesis 3:15. He's going to make good on that promise that he told Abraham that his descendants are going to be like the stars of the sky, the sands of the sea. He's going to make good on that promise that all the families of the earth are going to be blessed through Abraham's seed. And it's going to come through this family. This is a story, that God's upper story, that's about starvation and then provision. It's a story about slavery and deliverance. But boy, that isn't how it looks in Joseph's life. When you look at the lower story that Joseph is dealing with, it's completely different. It's a story of just keeping going down step after step, negative after negative, from golden child to stepchild, from stepchild to slave, from slave to prisoner, from prisoner then to governor. And then governor to restoration. I want you to think about those stages. And I want you to think about your lives right now. All of our locations, think about your lives. And hear me. If you haven't heard anything, hear this. God has an upper story hovering over your life. You're a part of God's upper story, and it is a marvelous story. It's a wonderful story. It's a magnificent story. It's a story with a happy ending. God will be glorified in your life. It's a wonderful story. But the fact is, sometimes we look at our story, and it doesn't feel that way. What's your lower story look like right now? You might be where? Just compare it to Joseph's life. Pick one. Pick golden child to stepchild. Do you feel like that? Have you ever felt like that? How about stepchild to slave? You ever feel like that? That you're just chained, that you're just bound to something in your life? You just don't know how you're going to get free? How about slave to prisoner? Have you felt like you've lost your entire reputation, that nobody cares about you, that you've just been forgotten, that you've dropped off the face of the earth? Man, does that connect with the stuff that Joseph went through? We need to have the attitude of Joseph, that no matter how the lower story looks, that we recognize that there's an upper story. And just hang in there. Don't give up and keep the attitude going, because God is faithful, right? The Bible says even if we're faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot disown himself. He's a faithful God. He's going to be there for you. And the most beautiful things happen in our lives when God's upper story connects with our lower story, and we get to see what God has been planning and what God has been doing. This is Palm Sunday weekend, right? Palm Sunday weekend. Think about Jesus, and I'm going to close with this. Look how Joseph's story connects with Jesus. Jesus comes to Jerusalem. He's the golden child, right? They put him on the colt of a donkey. He rides down the Kidron Valley and up onto Mount Moriah. He goes through the eastern gate of the temple. People are yelling and screaming, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes to the Son of David, right? And the Pharisees are saying, tell your servants and your friends and your followers to shut their mouths. And Jesus goes, listen, if they're quiet, the rocks are going to cry out. He's the golden child. Who's rejected him? His brothers. He's being rejected by his brothers. Before the end of the week, one of the closest people to him is going to sell him out, not for 20, but for 30 pieces of silver. Right? They're going to sell him into the hands of foreigners, Romans. And instead of becoming a slave, he's going to die on a cross, and he's going to shed his blood in atonement for our sins. That's the lower story. Jesus Christ endured a lower story for you. But can you see God's upper story? Can you see his upper story? Because that's not where God left him on that cross. After they pried those nails out of his dead body and they put him in a borrowed tomb, 3 days later, he rose from the dead. And God proved once and for all, he has the power to raise you from the dead. That it doesn't have to stay a lower story. That God's got a bigger plan. He's got a better plan. And that plan is to lift you up to his upper story. And that's what happened to Jesus. In Philippians 2:5, it says at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. And just like Joseph saw his brothers bow down, someday all of Jesus' brothers are going to bow down. And I'm going to bow down. And you're going to bow down. The upper story is God bringing people from starvation to provision. He said, I am the bread of life. He said he was the living water. He provides what we could never provide for ourselves. The upper story is God taking people from slavery into freedom. It's into freedom, to deliverance. And the beautiful part of it is when God's upper story and your lowest story connect. Listen to me now. God's upper story and your lower story can connect right now. It can happen this moment. And it happens by your choice. If you say, I want you, Jesus Christ, to be the Savior of my soul. I want you to be the Lord of my life. I want to take you and I want you to be in charge. I'm not going to wait till that last day. I'm going to start bowing down right now. And if you do that, God's upper story and your lower story are going to come together in this moment. It'll be one of the most awesome things, the most awesome thing that your life has ever experienced. We're moving to a time of decision.